How can we understand how fossil organisms like this beautiful extinct fossil fish here sense the world around them? If we could do this, then we could understand how the senses of organisms evolve as the world around them changed. Let's look at a specific example, fish. So the soft squidgy bits, eyes, ears, and up the nose, all these sensory bits and pieces tend not to fossilize, so they're not very good at working out how a fossil organism once sensed its environment. But fish and amphibians do have another sensory system called the lateral line system that we mammals don't have. And the lateral line system does fossilize. The lateral line system is described as touch at distance, and it basically is made up of a series of tubes and pipes down the sides of the fish, inside the skull, or underneath the skin of the fish itself. And inside these tubes and pipes are little hair cells that move when fluid moves back and forth inside the tube. And this flowing through the tubes and stimulating these nerve cells is a little bit like when you feel a whoosh in your hair as a train goes past you on a platform. Now we can find out how the lateral line system looks in fossil fish by examining the bones and the scales very, very closely. In particular, we can CT scan these fossils, which gives us a three-dimensional model of the lateral line. Now comes the maths and physics. We know from using computational fluid dynamics the pressure distribution over the head of a model fossil fish, and that tells us where the pressure is at the individual pore, canal, and tubes. So we want to be able to work out how, under different conditions, water flows down the lateral line canals in the fossil fish lateral line. And we've got all the information we need to from the CT scan and the maths and the physics. And remember, our hypothesis here is that the different shapes of lateral line, different diameters and lengths of pipe, will change and affect how sensitive the hair cells are in the lateral line canal itself. We know from modern fish that different lateral line shapes effectively serve different purposes. Some of them filter out different frequencies, and some of them are more susceptible to different types of stimulation. The lateral line is made up of connected tubes with holes open to the water that the fish is swimming in. As a fish or prey or even a water current moves over one of the lateral line holes, it changes the pressure at that hole. Now, if the pressure changes at one of these holes, the water in it will either have to move in or out, and the speed it moves in or out, the velocity, depends on that pressure and also the pressure at the other holes in the lateral line. If we add all these changes together, you can work out how fast the water is moving at the place in the lateral line where the hair cells are, and thus how much they will be moved. And from this, voila! You have just reconstructed how a fossil senses its environment, and all from a bunch of tubes and some maths. We could stop there, but the wonderful thing about these techniques is that we can also apply them to other sensory systems, including our own sensory systems. For example, inside our ear, we have our inner ear, which is an organ of balance, and all it is made up of is an interconnected series of pipes filled with fluids that stimulate little hair cells, just like the lateral line system. So we can use the same techniques on the inner ear, but it's a little bit more complicated because the shape of the inner ear that you get in a fossil is not the actual shape of the inner ear that functions. This is an exciting area of work that we're currently looking into, how to overcome these problems. But perhaps what is more exciting is repeating this exercise hundreds of times in a group of fish where we know the lateral line changes its shape, and also the environment they live in changes as well. If we were able to do this, and we can, it's just a matter of time, then we'd have all the information we need to design a special sensory system for an underwater remotely operated submarine, or an ROV. And this is a really exciting new area in paleontology called paleobiomimicry, where we can use the information we have from fossils and apply it to the real world.